Welcome to the Berks History Center's October 2016 program. My name is Sime Bertolet. I'm the Executive Director of the Berks History Center and your host for this show. Today, I'm joined by our education curator, Vicki Hefner, as well as Nathaniel Guest, and we're on location at the Colebrookdale Railroad in Boyertown. Welcome all to the October 2016 program. The Berks History Center is open Tuesday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. and on Saturday from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. The Henry Janssen Library, located directly behind the Berks History Center, is open Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. and on Saturday from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. The Berks History Center is located at 940 Center Avenue, and that's about a mile south of the First Energy Stadium on Route 61. The Henry Janssen Library, located directly behind our facility, is located at 160 Spring Street. Help the Berks History Center preserve the historic legacy of Berks County by joining the Berks History Center. It's a great way to support your community and the history that we all share. For as little as $35 for a primary membership, you can be a member of the Berks History Center. Individual memberships start at $55 and family memberships at $65. Member benefits include, for individual members and above, 4 issues to our quarterly journal, The Historical Review of Berks County, free admission to our library and our museum, and notifications on wonderful exhibits and programs that we hold, such as the second Saturday. And remember, memberships make a great gift.
Another added benefit of the membership to the Berks History Center is 10% off our museum store. While visiting the Berks History Center or the Henry Janssen Library, don't forget to stop by. There are unique gifts that celebrate the decorative arts and folk art of Berks County. The museum store also has an immense variety of toys, books, games, glassware, baskets, and more. Gift certificates are always available. If you like watching BCTV programs, such as the Berks History Center's monthly program, we encourage you to support BCTV by becoming a member of BCTV. For $45, your year's membership will help BCTV continue bringing local programming to you. Mail your check to BCTV, 1900 North 13th Street, Reading, PA, 19604. Upcoming events at the Berks History Center include our second Saturday program in October, which is on October the 8th, and it is our longtime volunteer Irv Rathman speaking on the Reading Markets and its celebration of their 250th anniversary. Also on October the 19th, the Henry Janssen Library Book Club will feature discussion on the Age of Gold, the California Gold Rush, and The New American Dream by H.W. Brands. The BHC's November 2nd Saturday program will feature speaker Lawrence Crawley presenting a history of the Patriotic Order of the Sons of the American of America to honor our veterans during November Veterans Month. Also, bus trips that are coming up. We are going to Great Gatsby's Gold Coast on December 4th, 5th, and 6th. We will be visiting Old Westbury Gardens, the Pitts Estate, Eagle's Nest, the Vanderbilt Mansion, Mill Neck Manor, Planting Fields Estates, Coe Hall, and Ohika Castle. The cost of this trip is $590 per person double occupancy, $775 single occupancy. If you would like more information, please call me at the Historical Society. I'm very excited about that trip. Charlie Adams will also be doing another trip with us, and he has titled it, he always comes up with great titles, he has titled this Poe and the B&O, and we will be going to Baltimore on Edgar Allan Poe's 208th birthday. We're visiting the B&O Railroad and then also having lunch at Fells Point and a mystery destination in the afternoon. And the cost of this trip is $85 for members, $95 for non-members, and the date is Thursday, January the 19th. So please let me know if you're interested. And just one more trip in the way future is April 27th through the 30th. We are going to the Azalea Festival in Virginia. We will be part of the tattoo convention that's there, and that is a military showing of bands that is a tradition in Norfolk. We will also be touring the Naval Base, MacArthur Memorial, and also a lot of other fun things. The cost of that trip, it's a really great price for 4 days. It's $650 per person, double occupancy, $800 for single. So please do call me if you'd like more information.
We're joined here at the Colebrookdale Railroad by Nathaniel Guest, the Executive Director of the Colebrookdale Railroad. And we're going to talk a little bit about this wonderful organization and their beautiful railroad cars, some of the history, what they're doing now. And so with that, I'll just, Nathaniel, welcome to the program.
Thank you. It's nice to be here.
Well, it's great to have you. Tell us a little bit about the Colebrookdale Railroad. I looked on the Berks and Schuylkill Journal, and it started in 1869, I think 4 months after the completion of the Transcontinental Railroad. Is that correct?
That's correct. The Colebrookdale Railroad is a little forgotten gem in
welcome to the Berks History Center's October 2016 program. My name is Sime Bertolet. I'm the Executive Director of the Berks History Center and your host for this show. Today, I'm joined by our education curator, Vicki Hefner, as well as Nathaniel Guest, and we're on location at the Colebrookdale Railroad in Boyertown. Welcome all to the October 2016 program. The Berks History Center is open Tuesday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. and on Saturday from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. The Henry Janssen Library, located directly behind the Berks History Center, is open Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. and on Saturday from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. The Berks History Center is located at 940 Center Avenue, and that's about a mile south of the First Energy Stadium on Route 61. The Henry Janssen Library located directly behind our facility, is located at 160 Spring Street. Help the Berks History Center preserve the historic legacy of Berks County by joining the Berks History Center. It's a great way to support your community and the history that we all share. For as little as $35 for a primary membership, you can be a member of the Berks History Center. Individual memberships start at $55 and family memberships at $65. Member benefits include, for individual members and above, 4 issues to our quarterly journal, The Historical Review of Berks County, free admission to our library and our museum, and notifications on wonderful exhibits and programs that we hold, such as the second Saturday. And remember, memberships make a great gift.
Another added benefit of the membership to the Berks History Center is 10% off our museum store. While visiting the Berks History Center or the Henry Janssen Library, don't forget to stop by. There are unique gifts that celebrate the decorative arts and folk art of Berks County. The museum store also has an immense variety of toys, books, games, glassware, baskets, and more. Gift certificates are always available. If you like watching BCTV programs, such as the Berks History Center's monthly program, we encourage you to support BCTV by becoming a member of BCTV. For $45, your year's membership will help BCTV continue bringing local programming to you. Mail your check to BCTV, 1900 North 13th Street, Reading, PA, 19604. Upcoming events at the Berks History Center include our second Saturday program in October, which is on October the 8th, and it is our longtime volunteer Irv Rathman speaking on the Reading Markets and its celebration of their 250th anniversary. Also on October the 19th, the Henry Janssen Library Book Club will feature discussion on the Age of Gold, the California Gold Rush, and the New American Dream by H.W. Brands. The BHC's November 2nd Saturday program will feature speaker Lawrence Crawley presenting a history of the Patriotic Order of the Sons of the American of America to honor our veterans during November Veterans Month. Also, bus trips that are coming up. We are going to Great Gatsby's Gold Coast on December 4th, 5th, and 6th. We will be visiting Old Westbury Gardens, the Pitts Estate, Eagle's Nest, the Vanderbilt Mansion, Mill Neck Manor, Planting Fields Estates, Coe Hall, and Ohika Castle. The cost of this trip is $590 per person double occupancy, $775 single occupancy. If you would like more information, please call me at the Historical Society. I'm very excited about that trip. Charlie Adams will also be doing another trip with us, and he has titled it, he always comes up with great titles, he has titled this Poe and the B&O, and we will be going to Baltimore on Edgar Allan Poe's 208th birthday. We're visiting the B&O Railroad, and then also having lunch at Fells Point and a mystery destination in the afternoon. And the cost of this trip is $85 for members, $95 for non-members, and the date is Thursday, January the 19th. So please let me know if you're interested. And just one more trip in the way future is April 27th through the 30th. We are going to the Azalea Festival in Virginia. We will be part of the tattoo convention that's there, and that is a military showing of bands that is a tradition in Norfolk. We will also be touring the Naval Base, MacArthur Memorial, and also a lot of other fun things. The cost of that trip, it's a really great price for 4 days. It's $650 per person double occupancy, $800 for single. So please do call me if you'd like more information.
We're joined here at the Colebrookdale Railroad by Nathaniel Guest, the Executive Director of the Colebrookdale Railroad. And we're going to talk a little bit about this wonderful organization and their beautiful railroad cars, some of the history, what they're doing now. And so with that, I'll just, Nathaniel, welcome to the program.
Thank you. It's nice to be here.
Well, it's great to have you. Tell us a little bit about the Colebrookdale Railroad. I looked on the Berks and Schuylkill Journal, and it started in 1869, I think 4 months after the completion of the Transcontinental Railroad. Is that correct?
That's correct. The Colebrookdale Railroad is a little forgotten gem in Berks and Montgomery counties. It was started just after the close of the Civil War and was built by soldiers who had returned home from the Civil War, completed after 4 years of hard labor by those soldiers in 1869, just as you said, 4 months after the driving of the Golden Spike. The railroad was very difficult to build, and while many folks don't think of the terrain between Pottstown and Boyertown as being particularly mountainous, we have every attribute of a high mountain railroad. So there's lots of creeks and tall trestles, deep rock cuts, and the railroad was very, very difficult to build. To give you some context, at the time the Transcontinental Railroad was built, they were building up to 10 miles of track every day. Mm-hmm. Now, we're just shy of 9 miles, and it took 4 years to build it. So a very, very difficult railroad for them to build, very, very beautiful railroad to enjoy today.
And it was only, 18 miles long from Boyertown to Pottstown.
8 miles long.
Excuse me, 8 miles
long. 8 miles long, just shy of nine.
I mean, that astounds me that it would be that they could look at that and then they look at a business model and say, we feel that that'll be a profitable route, and they built it.
Well, back in the 1860s, a connection to the railroad network was critical. So every community wanted to have a railroad connection. It was probably more important at that time than was, say, a highway exit off a superhighway is to a community today. Okay. Because the dramatic difference between the movement of people and goods by horse and carriage to the movement of people on steel wheels, on steel rails, was exponentially greater than the difference between railroad transportation and highway transportation, for instance. So the ability for industry to be competitive, the ability for farmers to get their products to market, really depended on a railroad connection. And those towns that did not have a facile connection to a railroad network really died at between the close of the 19th century and the early part of the 20th century. So if you were a town on the map, you wanted to have a railroad connection. And the same was true of Boyertown. This line in particular was built to serve the iron mines that line the railroad track on either side during most of our course from Boyertown to Pottstown and on the section of the line that used to continue from Boyertown to Bartow. Mm-hmm. You can imagine how very difficult it was to get raw materials into those iron industries that line the railroad track and then the finished iron products out when the only way to do it was on horse and wagon.
So this was this a kind of a spur line, a longer spur line, but one that they could pick up the goods from depots along the way to Boyertown, but they could also run passengers to Boyertown, pick up the goods, bring it back, and then they would take it back to take it to Philadelphia.
That's right. I mean, the Colebrookdale was started as an independent railroad line, and like many small independent railroads, it became part of a larger system. This railroad became part of the Reading Railroad, or the Philadelphia and Reading Railroad originally. And the way you might think of it is that the Colebrookdale Railroad is kind of a capillary in the circulatory system that is the National Railroad Network. And so it fed into a larger artery and then finally into the trunk lines that went into Philadelphia and beyond. So milk and produce and other goods that were produced out here in the countryside were delivered by morning trains to Philadelphia, to Reading Terminal. And then when the trains reached Reading Terminal, they would pick up mail and other products destined for the hinterland at that point, here in Boyertown, and they were delivered at each of the stations along the line. Additionally, the railroad also used to haul school children. So back before there were school buses, children could hop on the Colebrookdale trains and then hop off at any number of the one-room schoolhouses there were along the railroad.
And the Colebrookdale also had played a significant role in one of the darker sides of the history of Boyertown. That was the Rhodes Opera House fire.
That's right. Yeah, the Rhodes Opera House fire occurred right behind where we're sitting right now, right adjacent to the railroad station. So literally the folks at the train station had a front row seat to the horror that unfolded there. The railroad was used to bring fire engines from all around, fire trucks from all around the area to fight the fire. Unfortunately, as efficient as the railroad was, by the time the fire trucks got here, it was too late to save the folks that were inside the Opera House. Those were some of the fastest recorded train times on the Colebrookdale Railroad, better than 60 miles an hour, on a track that today we don't really ever break 15.
Well,
it must have been moving and shaking pretty good to get that fire truck here. So the Goodwill pumper, for instance, was loaded in downtown Pottstown onto a flat car and then brought up here as fast as they could to Boyertown. And it made it within, as I recall, about a half hour, which is pretty remarkable.
Yeah.
You figure to fire up a steam-powered fire truck, load it onto a railroad flat car, and bring it 13 miles in a half hour, it was pretty remarkable
at
the
time.
The Colebrookdale was then also used to bring many, many undertakers from all over the region who came and donated their services to take care of the folks who had perished in the fire, and then also lots of spectators because it was sort of a macabre kind of event, and there were people from all over the country who came here to Boyertown for the funeral services.
When was the last run of the Colebrookdale Railroad before its rebirth by your organization?
Well, the railroad was never actually formally abandoned. It came very, very close during numerous times in its history. First, in 1976, when the Reading Railroad went bankrupt and was merged into part of what became Conrail, this line was not one of the lines that Conrail took over. So it was either going to be abandoned or taken over by another entity. Luckily, the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania stepped in and took over ownership of the line and leased it to various owners over the years. The County of Berks then bought it from the Commonwealth, and then it was transferred to a private entity. Twice during that time, it almost was abandoned. And then we stepped in the County of Berks stepped in again in 2006 through 2008 to save the line from abandonment, and we took over operations in 2013.
Okay.
During that time, all of that time, the line was passable for freight service.
Right.
And there were long stretches where there were no freight trains, but the line was never actually officially closed for service. The last passenger train happened in the 1950s, the last all-passenger train, and then there were some mixed trains that would be actually a passenger car put on the back of a freight train. But there's an article that proudly announced that the service between Boyertown and Pottstown would be taken over by a luxury air-conditioned bus. And so a bus service from provided by the Reading Company took over the service between Boyertown and Pottstown. And then I think there were a number of special excursions during the period of the 50s and 60s when there were no scheduled passenger trains, but just a special events. And then the station was demolished in 1976.
Okay.
And that sort of was the death knell for any passenger service here until we returned.
Well, I'm looking around, and the audience, you just can't grasp how beautiful this car is. And I know that on future programs, we're going to be doing BCTV programs with Colebrookdale on some of their other cars. But tell us a little bit about the events that you've got going, you know, that you have going on here, and you know, what the community, you know, can take part in. Because if you haven't seen this yet, you really need to. This is great.
Well, thank you for your thoughts on our passenger cars. These truly are among the most beautiful passenger cars anywhere in the world, and they're beautiful in their own right. But what makes them even more special is when you realize that 90% of the work that went into restoring what were derelict passenger cars were done by local volunteers, people who believe in the cause of resurrecting the Colebrookdale Railroad and what it can do for our communities. They donated their time and their money to make this possible. And these cars really are priceless, and you cannot have this experience anywhere else in the country. Speaking of experiences, so as you mentioned, we do have quite a few special events on the railroad. The railroad really is an armature for memory making, and so what we try to do is make the experience memorable, not just because of the beautiful scenery, the wonderful history that you learn, and the beautiful train cars, but also because of the exciting activities that are happening on board the train. So, for instance, every Saturday night, we have a dinner train that includes entertainment and a wonderful gourmet meal served aboard our cafe car, and of course the rest of the train is open for inspection. This car is used as a wine tasting car. And then all passengers have the opportunity to ride our Secret Valley Explorer open car, which is a wonderful open deck car that gives 360-degree views of the beautiful scenery along the Secret Valley route. We have Sunday brunch trains.
Mm-hmm.
Our most popular trains are coming up during the last quarter of the year, which include our fall foliage trains. We have been blessed with what travel magazines have called some of the most spectacular fall foliage anywhere in Pennsylvania, and it's right here on our railroad track, and the only way to see it is on our train, which is sort of wonderful for
us.
Our open car is transformed into a hayride on rails. We have hay bales out on the open car, and you can sip hot cider and eat cider donuts and listen to bluegrass music as we make our way to Pottstown and back. On Saturday and Friday evenings, we have bonfire trains, which you can go down to the old abandoned iron-making village of Colebrookdale.
Uh-huh.
And enjoy a bonfire, music, hot apple cider, and all the s'mores that you care to eat. A short train ride with a wonderful bonfire thrown in. And then this year we'll be hosting for the first time Thanksgiving dinner trains. So if you don't want to cook Thanksgiving dinner, you can leave the dinner and the dishes to us, and we'll take care of that right on board the train.
How long is that excursion?
It's a two-hour excursion.
Wow.
And then we have our most popular trains of the year are our Santa Claus trains. And so every Friday, Saturday, and Sunday between Thanksgiving and Christmas, Santa Claus joins us on board the train. And if you've seen the movie The Polar Express, you know the magic of trains at Christmas,
sure.
And this really sets the standard. I'm not just patting ourselves on the back, but we do a really good job here. And if you want a really memorable, remarkable, truly special Santa Claus experience, this is how to do it. Because Santa Claus visits every child on board the train, he brings a gift for every child. Plenty of time, a lot more time than you'll find with Santa at the mall, let's put it that way,
right
here on board our train. We have a 19th century hot chocolate machine that our dining car stewards wheel down the coaches,
okay.
And you get the best hot chocolate you've ever had, and complimentary cookies, and we sing carols. You can get your picture taken with Santa, and the elves print the pictures out on board, and you can take them home with you that same day. Also this year, we'll be stopping at a Secret Santa Village, where you can hop out, pick out your Christmas tree, and we load the Christmas tree onto our open car and take it back to Boyertown. So it really is a special event. A lot of work for our volunteers. It is a tremendous, tremendous commitment from our volunteers, but it's very wonderful.
Where can the audience get more information about some of these?
ColebrookdaleRailroad.com is
okay.
Our website. That's ColebrookdaleRailroad.com, railroad.com, railroad spelled out. You can also call us at 610-367-0200, and we'll be glad to let you know about all of our excursions and custom make a visit for any of the passengers who wish to ride.
Tell us about some of the other events that we haven't covered yet, in the life of the Colebrookdale Railroad.
Well, the Colebrookdale has a just unexpectedly remarkable history, and if you attended our locomotive dedication back in May, you'll see that our newly restored locomotive has a beautiful broad stripe of Pennsylvania blue. It's the color that Pennsylvania established as its first official color in 1914. And folks said, well, why would you paint the locomotive in that scheme? And the answer is because there's so much about the Colebrookdale Railroad and the valley that the Colebrookdale passes through that is critical to the identity of Pennsylvania that most folks don't know about, even those who grew up here like me. The oldest iron-making industry in Pennsylvania,
mm-hmm.
a state whose empire was built in iron foundries, was right here along this railroad, named the Colebrookdale Iron Works. The rock cuts that the Colebrookdale passes through contain iron ores unique in all of the world that were one of the reasons why those iron industries were established here. And those iron ore deposits drew folks from all over the world here to study them. They're magnetic.
Okay.
And one of the folks that it drew was Thomas Edison. So Thomas Edison rode this railroad every week for 6 years. Now you can imagine the level of commitment to come each week for 6 years from northern New Jersey to Boyertown, Pennsylvania. He apparently was quite a sensation locally, much to the irritation of the railroad conductors, because Mr. Edison would hop out and sample the ores along the line, really whenever Mr. Edison wanted to. Very difficult to keep a train schedule. There's also a really wonderful geologic history of the railroad. Each year, Temple University sends its entire geology department here to study the rock cuts along the line for their fossil record. And I'm not a geologist. I'll say that I'm even less of a geologist than I am a historian, so I'm not sure I'm going to get the story completely right, but from what they tell us, they're one of only two locations in the world, right here along the railroad, where you can see the complete geologic record of the supercontinent Pangaea, when all of the continents were once one. And so the other place is North Africa. We're a lot closer from Philadelphia.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's a really wonderful place that is core to the identity of what it means to be from this region and from Pennsylvania.
I've never known that. That's incredible. That's why. Do you transport them, or how do they provide their own transport?
They bring their own transport, Yeah, we've offered the train up, but they like the exercise.
Okay, all right.
We have a number of other special events that are coming up. You had asked me about our fall foliage trains, or I mentioned about our fall foliage trains and our Santa Claus trains. Every holiday we have something special going on here at the railroad, from a Mother's Day tea. Mm-hmm. You can enjoy English tea here on board the Colebrookdale Railroad. It's a very popular event. Valentine's trains, Father's Day beef and beer trains. We recently hosted a cigar and brandy train. As we were rolling down the track from the open car, the smoke billowing from all the cigars looked like we had a steam engine up front.
They were on the open car.
Yeah, we have them in here.
That's a politically correct world. We know that. They would have been smoking cigars in the day in this.
Probably would have been blue with smoke, but we're not going to do that in here. We also had a steam locomotive visit us in May, which we may look to do again relatively soon. So.
Well, that brings up a good point. What propels or pulls this your train cars? Is it a steam or is it a diesel locomotive?
It's a historic diesel locomotive, first generation diesel locomotive built by the electromotive division of General Motors.
So is that your rolling stock?
That's our locomotive, and then all the cars that it pulls are our rolling stock. Right now we have this first class parlor car. We have a garden cafe car decorated like an Edwardian garden party. It's pretty spectacular. We also have a deluxe coach, which is our baseline accommodation, but probably the nicest coach you'll ride in anywhere. The open car that I mentioned is open to all passengers. We also have under restoration, a luxury dining car, a 1914 smoking lounge car, which is up on blocks over in the railroad yard, as well as a baggage car on the way, and a few other cars that we may fix up in the future.
So. Okay. Can you give us an idea, what does it take to restore a car like this in both man hours and financial, monetary?
Yeah.
I mean, can you divulge it? And I understand it.
Yeah, well, it takes about 2 years to do a restoration like this.
And that's all volunteer.
That's just the years off the end of my life trying to get it done. It's 2 years of volunteer effort, which is remarkably fast when you realize that when this car came to the railroad, it had no windows, no seats, no heat, no electric, no bathroom, nothing that you see was here. All the windows, the roof, the floor, everything needed to be replaced. The restoration, just materials, was about $180,000. Much of those, many of those materials were donated, or the money to purchase them was donated. And so that plus the volunteer labor results in a car like this that, you know, on the market, if you could find another car like this, you'd be looking at anywhere from $300,000 to $500,000 to buy a car like this.
In this condition?
In this condition.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
If you could find one.
And I look at the gilt work, I look at the Tiffany's, you know, lamps, just the appointments on this, the stained glass, it's remarkable. That doesn't surprise me at all.
Well, we have a proud tradition of exquisite craftsmanship in Pennsylvania, and this car is meant to showcase it.
Your volunteers, do they come, are they from the immediate area, or do they come far and wide from all parts of the state?
They come from all over. Most of our volunteers are relatively local, within, half hour to 40 minutes, but we've had volunteers come from other states, sporadically, right? Our passengers come from all over, which is something that we're just thrilled about, that we've had during the course of our first year, passengers from every state in the country, about a dozen foreign nations since we've started. We actually had a bus tour that came here from, I believe it was Iowa. They had traveled from the Midwest, and their itinerary was the Flight 93 Memorial in Shanksville, the Statue of Liberty in Ellis Island in New York City, the Liberty Bell in Philadelphia, and the Colebrookdale Railroad in Berks County.
Thank goodness for the internet.
Yeah, exactly. Right? So we were very pleased about that.
I'd like to thank Vicki Hefner and our guest Nathaniel Guest and the Colebrookdale Railroad for joining us for today's program. It really is a wonderful organization. I'd also like to thank you for watching. I encourage all of you to come visit us at the Berks History Center to see the wonderful new exhibits that we have. We've installed 6 new ones in the last year, and also stop by the Henry Onsen Library. One more thing, don't forget to visit the BCTV archives to watch these programs from their archives. Once again, thank you so much for being with us, and we look forward to having you with us on the November 2016 program.